أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبي إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Last night I began speaking about these different ahadith that we have from the Ahlul Bayt themselves that speak to the importance, the significance, the reward for having these majalis. Tonight I'd like to turn to the topic that I'd like to continue from now until the ninth, inshallah. And that is that, as I mentioned yesterday, I want to focus on the story of Karbala itself. I'll give you a little insight, kind of a glance at my own thought process. I myself, at the risk of maybe giving too much information, but I think it's beneficial. I myself have struggled. You might know I'm not born into international Shiism. I was born as an Ismaili Pora, and then in college I ended up converting over and becoming international. And then even then I didn't really know too much. I didn't have access to much knowledge until I finally decided to go to the Hausa. And so really my journey in building my faith and understanding my faith began around 2000 when I entered the Hausa. Even through that process and past that process of learning the deen, I've struggled with these majalis and with the commemorations of Imam Hussein. One of the effects of that struggle was that for many years, until last year, I would always, in my speeches during Muharram, I would view the majalis of Muharram as really a platform in which we gathered together to learn about Islam in general. So I saw it as a way for us to kind of almost, just for the excuse of the majlis, and just because of the barakah of Imam Hussein, we would end up gathering together, and then this would be a class then. And I would use this platform to teach about some topic, either tafsir or history or whatever the topic was. I would choose that for the 10 days. But I would never focus on Imam Hussein himself, except for in the masalib, in telling the stories. But over time, I've started to understand, especially through the help of these ahadith and just through reflection as well, that, as I mentioned yesterday, there's great need for education on all aspects of Islam. And there are other opportunities that we have and we must avail ourselves of during the rest of the year to engage in that kind of education, through study, through lectures, through all sorts of different means. But I think now that these majalis are primarily meant for specifically remembering Imam Hussein himself and reflecting on the story of Karbala itself. Right? So I want to act on that new realization of my own, and that's the reason I've chosen this idea, to reflect on the story of Karbala itself. So as I mentioned, many of the storytelling is going to be things that you've heard before, that you've read before. That's not so important necessarily. Oftentimes people feel like every lecture that they listen to, it must give them something new. And if there's not some new idea, then it's a waste of time. But if you use the logic of the Qur'an, or use the logic of our repetitive prayers of Salah, we see that gaining new information is highly overrated. There's a whole lot that we can understand and that we can gain from simply reviewing the same old material that we already know, but we often forget. In fact, we continuously, inevitably forget. It's in our very nature. There's so many things that are in our mind, so many things that we've learned before, but they're not at the forefront of our mind. One of the struggles that people have when they open the Qur'an is that it's, for one thing, disorganized. It's not organized in the way that we expect, and people become frustrated with that. Orientalists have often criticize the Quran as just a jumble of you know, random sentences that somebody's, you know, pieced together. And honestly, frankly, when you read it, that is a first impression. One of the explanations that some of our scholars, especially Sayyid Khoui, has put forward is that the wisdom behind the design of the Qur'an is that on a daily basis, in your daily 2-page, 3-page recitation, 5-page, 20-page, whatever your daily dosages of the Qur'an, you end up with reminders of all of those major concepts that are necessary for us to constantly keep in mind. If it were designed in a way where chapter 1 was on Tawheed, and chapter 2 was on Nubuwwah, and chapter 10 was on Salah, and so forth, then you would read about Allah and His attributes at the beginning of the Qur'an, at the beginning of your cycle of recitation, but then by chapter 2 and 3 and 10 and 30, you would no longer have any mention of God anymore, and it would take you, you know, however long it takes you to go through one cycle of the Qur'an before you have information and reminders about Allah again. And that would be a terrible way to design a book that's meant for this other purpose of daily recitation. So anyway, my point is that constant reminder, even sometimes of things that we already know, is extremely valuable. Our prayer itself, we don't ever read anything new in the prayer. That would be bid'ah if we introduce something in the prayer that wasn't already part of the sunnah of the prayer. So necessarily, even to have the prayer be correct, we need to pray it formulaically exactly as given to us by the Prophet. صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. And the Prophet's admonition was, pray as you see me pray. And so we pray constantly, 5 times a day, maybe more if we add the nawafil, exact same prayer, day in, day out. Nothing new, yet that's the backbone, that's imadul deen. It's the pillar on which the rest of the deen rests. If that's straight, then the rest of our deen is straight, and if that's crooked, the rest of our deen is crooked. And for that reason, the constant reminders, the constant recitation of the same adhkar and the same surahs of the Qur'an is instructive and important for us. So let's spend some time from now until the eve of Ashura reflecting on the story. I want to go through and recount the story for you, and then pause at various junctures in the story and give some reflections, give some insights into what's happening, what conversations are taking place, what's the reason behind it, what lessons can we gain from all of them. Recite the salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
So the story of Karbala, you could trace it back and start it at probably a couple of different places. Ziyarat Ashura teaches us that the beginning of Karbala is right after the Prophet's death at Saqifah. Allahumma la'an. Maybe it starts. Wa la'natullahi ala ummatin. No, I'm preparing the beginning. It's Allahumma la'an. Anyway, so it's Allah curse ummatan assasat asasa dhulmi wa jawri alaykum ahl al bayt. I've forgotten how that particular phrase begins. But it's calling down the damnation of God on those who opened the door, initiated that first transgression against the Ahlul Bayt by allowing leadership and wilaya to move from the family of the Prophet outside the family of the Prophet. That first step that was taken, it was a slippery slope that was then headed down by the entire Ummah, because those first people decided that wilaya didn't have to stay in the family of the Prophet, and a non-ma'sum, someone who's not guided directly by Allah, is good enough that he can also lead us, as well as the family of the Prophet. Allahumma al'an awwal al-zalim. No, that's at the end of the... but this is Ummatan assasat asas al-zulma. This is towards the beginning of the Islam. But I want to start at the death of Imam Hassan alayhi salam. When he was martyred. So he was martyred about 10 years before Karbala, in the year 1551. He was martyred, of course, by the hand of Muawiyah through the agency of his own wife, Ja'da. Ja'da was encouraged and paid off by Muawiyah in quite a large sum of money, and promised even marriage, the hand of Yazid in marriage, if she would do this and assassinate her husband, Imam Hassan. And Ja'ada, we'll encounter her family throughout the story several times. She's the daughter of Ash'ath ibn Qais. And Al-Ash'ath ibn Qais, at one time, he had been a companion of the Imam, of Imam Ali alayhi salam. There are some interactions between the Imam and him that are recorded in Nahj al-Balagha as well that are quite favorable. But he was also one of the people who deviated from the Imam, joined the ranks of the Khawarij, in fact was one of the leaders of the Khawarij. And we'll see that Ash'ath ibn Qais, he had a hand in the assassination of Imam Ali alayhi salam, one of the people who supported and helped and facilitated Abdurrahman ibn Muljim in his efforts to assassinate Imam Ali alayhi salam. So his hands are guilty, are stained with the blood of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Ja'ada, his daughter, is responsible for poisoning Imam Hassan alayhi salam. And then her two brothers, Muhammad, and I believe the other one's name is Abdurrahman, I may be mistaken in his name, but they also played a role in the lead up and in the day of Karbala itself. One of the brothers was involved in arresting Muslim ibn Aqim and then leading him to Ibn Ziyad, where he was eventually killed by Ibn Ziyad. And then one other brother is on the battlefield at Karbala and on the Kufan side, and he's one of the people who is mentioned in the Maqatib as one of the people who was a leader and one of those people who fought against Imam Hussein. So this family is a family of wretches, of people who were traitors to Islam and who all had the blood of the Masumin on their hands. When Imam Hassan passes away, there is an upheaval amongst the Shia and the followers of the Ahlul Bayt. He had been bound by the treaty that he had signed with Muawiyah almost 10 years before. When he passes away, the Shia, especially of Kufa, they begin sending letters continuously to Imam Hussein alayhi salam, saying that now's the time. Right, rise up, we'll support you, we have this many number of people and we have, you know, everything's ready. Let's do it now. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he cites the treaty with Muawiyah as his reason for not doing it. Right, so he holds himself to the same standard that Imam Hassan held himself, and he says that my brother Imam Hassan, he had signed this treaty with Muawiyah. And because of that treaty, I am still bound to that. And one of the terms of the treaty, the treaty had many terms. The treaty was in part Imam Hassan's way of alleviating war. One of the terms that he had stated in there, the practice that Muawiyah had started, was this practice of reciting La'an of Imam Ali alayhi salam and even some of the other members of the Ahlul Bayt in public. Part of the wajibat of Jumu'ah, and even in the qunut of the prayer, he would have La'an on Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. And so one of the things that Imam Hassan insisted on was that this be stopped, and so he used that treaty as a platform to stop that. At least to publicly make that stance, it didn't stop though. Another term that Imam Hassan had put in the treaty was that the persecution of the Shia of Imam Ali, of Imam Hassan, should be stopped as well. That they shouldn't be persecuted, they shouldn't be treated any differently because of their affiliation with the Imams. Another term that he put in there was that Muawiyah would get the Khilafah, that he would be the Khalifa as long as he lived, but he would have no right to appoint a successor on his own, but rather, when he passed away, if Imam Hassan is still alive, the Khilafah would pass back to Imam Hassan alayhi salam, and if he were to pass away before Muawiyah, then it would pass on to Imam Hassan's successor, which would be Imam Hussein. So this was all part of the treaty that Imam Hassan and Muawiyah had agreed to. Immediately after that treaty was signed, Muawiyah's response was that, yes, I've agreed to all these terms. In fact, in a khutbah that he had delivered in Kufa itself, right, he said that we've signed all these things, we've agreed to all these things, but he says, Jami'uha tahta qadamayn. And all of these terms of the treaty, I put them under my feet and I trample on them. La afi bi shay'in minha lahu. I'm not going to fulfill any of these conditions, these stipulations that Hassan has put for me. I'm not going to act on any of them. And he doesn't. We see that people like Hujr ibn Adi are killed. And we see that the La'an of Amir al-Mu'mineen continues during this time as well. So he doesn't fulfill his end of the bargain. Nonetheless, Imam Hassan, and now we see Imam Hussein, continue to hold up their end of the bargain to fulfill their end of the treaty. So Imam Hussein uses this as his excuse, and he says that these terms are still standing, I'm still bound by this treaty, and for that reason we are not going to, we're not going to rise up. On one hand, you can see the virtue of abiding by your treaty. And the Quran in Surah Al-Ma'idah, the very first verse says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَوْفُوا بِالْعُقُودِ. Whatever covenants and contracts you have engaged in, fulfill them. That's a general principle, and a universal principle, that's a virtue throughout all religions. But on the other hand, we see that a treaty, a covenant of this sort, is a two-sided bargain. Both sides have to fulfill their end of it, and if one side doesn't, then the bargain itself, the covenant itself, is no longer valid. So why then would Imam Hassan or Imam Hussein hold themselves to this covenant if the other side has not held up their end of the bargain? So it seems that Imam Hussein has several reasons for doing this. One is taqiyya. And he realizes and he knows that he's not truly in a position. Yes, there's a lot of talk amongst the Kufans. They claim that they will support him at this time. This is, again, after Imam Hassan's passing away. They claim that they'll support him, but he knows the reality of Muawiyah and his strength, and that the Shia of Kufa are not equipped to be able to deal with that. Right, Muawiyah, one of the dangers of an enemy like Muawiyah is that he is a master of deception. He's able to put on a beautiful front. And we have probably a mental image of what he must have looked like or behaved like. But in all honesty, when you read about him and you see the reaction that people had towards him, he was probably a good-looking person, probably an eloquent person, probably someone who could quote Quran backwards and forwards, someone who could give you the impression that he is a righteous person. And at the same time, as soon as he gets you feeling that he's righteous, he'll come and stab you in the back in a way that you never even realized it was coming. He had the ability, we saw at the Battle of Siffin, he had the ability to turn the tides of the battle just at the nick of time. As he was about to be killed himself by Malik al-Ashtar, they were able to play the trick on the Muslims and the simpletons amongst the Muslims by saying, we turn ourselves over to the Hakimiyyah of the Qur'an, let the Qur'an be the judge between us and you. And they put the pieces of the Qur'an on the spear, saying, we'll submit to the Qur'an. And the gullible simpletons amongst Imam Ali's army, they buy it, and they say, how can we fight with the Qur'an? They also follow the Qur'an, they're willing to submit to the Qur'an. If we continue to fight, we're fighting against the Qur'an. The Imam says, I am the Qur'an. Don't be fooled by these claims and these slogans that they have. Right? I am the Qur'an. I am the standard. But he's not able to convince them. Muawiyah is powerful enough, his propaganda is powerful enough, his trickery is powerful enough, that he's able to deceive Imam Ali's soldiers, and that battle ends up as a total failure. And then Imam Hassan faces even worse challenges from Muawiyah, and his efforts fail even worse. And he's not even able to get to the battlefield with an army intact. He loses all his support. Many of his key people are bought off by Muawiyah, and they end up switching sides. And through different kinds of trickery, Muawiyah is able to spread rumors amongst the army of Imam Hassan. And by the end, he doesn't even have enough manpower to be able to launch a battle against Muawiyah. In fact, even his own soldiers, they turn on him, and they end up stabbing him in the leg and disabling him, so he can't, even when he goes to sign the treaty with Muawiyah, he has to be carried on a stretcher to be able to engage in those negotiations. So Imam Hussein knows that Muawiyah is still in power, and his ability to control and to deceive is no less than it was before, and these Kufans, even though they have these claims, they're not going to be able to withstand his trickery. And so it's better for the Imam, and better for the Ummah at large, to maintain at least the appearance of a treaty and hold up their end of the bargain. And this is better for the Muslims themselves, the Shias themselves. It's similar to Hudaybiyah, it's similar to some of the other circumstances that we had in the time of the Prophet or the time of Imam Ali Islam, where maintaining a treaty even under the under less than perfect circumstances was better in the long run than not doing that. So this is probably some of the reasons why Imam Hussein holds to this. He also maintains the moral high ground. And history can't record any instance where Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein went against the treaty. Right? If they had, even though they were justified, even though no one would have blamed them for breaking the treaty, since Muawiyah had already initiated the breaking of the treaty. But just to prevent anyone from ever being able to even mention that as a complaint against Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein, they maintain that moral high ground, and at least they fulfill their end of the bargain. So it seems like some of these are the reasons why strategically the Imam saw that it's better to maintain this treaty during this time. This continues until Muawiyah's death. And this is where the maqatil usually start. So in the year 60, so about 6 months before where we are right now, in the year 60, on Rajab the 15th is when Muawiyah finally passes away. When he passes away, there is again a stir in the Ummah. Before anything can happen, before news can spread, Yazid tries to preempt any insurgency against him. And Muawiyah was, he had the claim that he's a companion of the Prophet, he had built up this image as the scribe of the Prophet, he's Katib Rasulullah. He had those claims, and he, like I mentioned, he had the ability to put on a show as being someone who's righteous and holy. Yazid had none of that. Yazid was known far and wide to be Shadib al-Khumur, someone who openly drinks, who openly does all sorts of evil acts. It was an open thing for him. Muawiyah did it behind closed doors. He was tactful in how he did his haram, but Yazid was not. And so he knew that as soon as it becomes known that Muawiyah has died and now this Yazid, who's a profligate, is now the ruler, there will be revolt everywhere. And so before anything can happen, before any organization can take place on the part especially of his staunchest enemies who are the Shia, he makes sure to send out word secretly through messengers to those from whom he fears the most. So he sends his messengers to Medina, and there are three individuals there who are his biggest fear. One is the personality of Abdullah ibn Zubayr. So Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam is one of the companions of the Prophet, one of the foremost of the companions of Imam Ali alayhi salam as well. One of those people who stood by him during Saqifa and after that as well, along with Talha and others. And there were strong supporters of him throughout the Khilafah of the other three Khulafa. It was only after Imam Ali is finally given Bay'ah, and he makes the decision not to give Zubayr and Talha the governorship of Kufa and Basra, which they had their eyes set on. They felt like, now we can cash in. All the years of loyalty that we've given to Ali, now it should pay off. Now it's his turn to scratch our back. And when Imam Ali refused to do that, and he didn't give them that governorship, they revolted against him. And that's where the battle of Jamal comes in, the battle of Basra, where they team up with Aisha, and they fight against Imam Ali. And in that battle, both Zubayr and Talha are killed. Abdullah ibn Zubayr is, according to Imam Ali, the source of Zubayr's treachery. It was the son who made the father evil, who convinced him to fight against his old friend, and eventually led to his own death. So Abdullah ibn Zubayr is a powerful person, a person with influence, and we'll see, even after, in the aftermath of Karbala, he's the next contender for the Khilafah. He's the one who launches his revolution from Mecca has his battles over the next decade after Karbala, and he is eventually killed as well as the entire Kaaba is burned and the Masjid al-Haram is burned because of his battle with Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. So Abdullah bin Zubayr is someone that Yazid fears, and so he sends one messenger to him. One messenger for the purpose of also getting Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab, who was another powerful tabi'i. He's the son of Umar ibn Khattab. And the third, of course, is Imam Hussein alayhi salam. So he sends words to his governor, who is his cousin also, Walid ibn Utbah ibn Abi Sufyan. So think Abu Sufyan, and his sons are Utbah and Muawiyah, and their sons are Walid and Yazid. So Walid and Yazid are second cousins. Walid is the governor of Medina, and Yazid sends word to him that you need to, as soon as possible, without letting anyone else know what has happened, send word to these three individuals, summon them, and immediately give them the choice of either giving their immediate and unconditional bay'ah to me, or you kill them on the spot. Walid does this, he sends word to these three individuals. Abdullah ibn Umar, he's not really a political person. He is more known for being kind of someone who'll go into the corner and worship, and he's content just worshipping, and he's not concerned with these kinds of affairs. And so he quickly capitulates, and he's not an issue. Abdullah bin Zubayr, his reaction is immediately he consults with Imam Hussein, and they understand what's going on, and he flees. So he goes to Mecca, where he has allies, he has connections, and he immediately goes there and starts his activities over there. Imam Hussein, alayhi salam, he also understands what this must mean. A message like this at this time of the night, at an unconventional time, can only mean one thing, that something significant like this has happened. Muawiyah is in failing health, and probably this is an announcement that he's dead. So he takes due precaution. He gathers the men from the Ahlul Bayt together, fully armed. They go to the Darul Khilafah, where Walid has summoned him, and he goes in, having arranged with his escorts that if I raise my voice, if you hear my voice from inside, then you charge in with swords wielded, and you come and protect him and you know, defend him. Other than that, you stay at the door and wait for my command. So Imam Hussein goes in and he speaks to Walid. With Walid is one of his distant cousins, Marwan. So Marwan ibn al-Hakam, he'll eventually become the contender for the Umayyad dynasty. Right? We know about Muawiyah and Yazid. After Karbala, after Yazid passes away, there's no other viable candidate from this line of Abu Sufyan to take over the Khilafah. And so the descendants of Marwan then, they take over the Khilafah, and after much contention and warfare and fighting with Ibn Zubayr and all these different things, the Marwanis end up becoming the Umayyads. So the Umayyads that we know after them are all the descendants of the same Marwan Ibn Hakam who's there with Walid in this gathering. So Walid delivers the message of Yazid to Imam Hussein and says, here's what's happened, Muawiyah has died, and you have these two choices of either submitting and pledging your allegiance, or it's death. Imam Hussein's response to him is that someone like me, to give you a pledge of allegiance in these kinds of circumstances, in a private meeting at night, away from the public view, it doesn't help you at all. If I want to be honest with you, if you want to, you know, make my pledge mean something and empower Yazid and solidify your power, we should wait till tomorrow when everyone gathers in the masjid and during one of the Jama'ah prayers at some major gathering, call everyone together, and at that sort of circumstance, that's when this bay'ah should take place. Not in this kind of back room. And so by doing this, Imam Hussein is able to buy some time. Walid jumps on the opportunity. He loves the suggestion because he himself is not willing to have Imam Hussein's blood on his hands. He is Umayyad, he is the cousin of Yazid, but he has some softness to this matter. He himself, so Marwan jumps in, he says that, you know, this is if he leaves now, you'll never hear from him again. You'll never see him again. You'll never have an opportunity like this to force him to take one of these two choices. This is a terrible mistake, Marwan tells his cousin Walid, but Walid, nonetheless, he likes Imam Hussein's suggestion. It buys him time, he doesn't have to be guilty of this. So when Marwan speaks up and says, no, you have to kill him now or make him do the bay'ah, Imam Hussein's response is, first of all, he calls me Yabna Zarqa. But Ibn Zarqa was a derogatory name, a title for the grandmother of Marwan. She was an unrighteous woman, well known to be like that. And so the Imam specifically, instead of calling him by his name Marwan or Ibn al-Hakam or anything else, he calls him Yabna Zarqa. And he says, are you going to kill me with your own hands, or is Wali? Who amongst you is willing to have my blood on your hands? And that puts Marwan a little bit at bay as well. So one issue to realize or to think about is why the Imam would use this kind of an insult. Right, we have in the Quran, Surah Al-Hujurat, وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. We're not supposed to call names. We're not supposed to insult people by calling them names. But we see Imam Hussein doing it here, and we see later on in the aftermath of Karbala, when Lady Zainab and with Imam Sajjad go into the court of Ibn Ziyad and then into the court of Yazid, they use these sorts of names as well. Lady Zainab calls Ibn Ziyad Ibn Sunayya. Right? And she refers to him, reminding him of his mother, who was also an unrighteous woman. Right? So they use these titles for these people, Yabna Tulaqa, they use for Yazid, reminding him of his ancestry in the conquest of Mecca, when the Prophet had every right and every justification to kill Abu Sufyan and Hind and all the rest, but out of his graciousness, he decides to let them go and says, anyone who's in the house of Abu Sufyan is safe. Right? So he frees them, he makes them taliq, like as though they're free, when they should have been imprisoned or even executed and killed. And so this sticks as an insult in that lineage, that they're abna al-tulaqa, they're the descendants of those people who were graciously freed by the hand of Muhammad when he had every right to kill them. Salawat
Muhammad.
So the insults that they use, first of all, they're truthful insults. They don't make up things, they're not lying and saying false things to them. They're not even using adjectives to describe them and say you're like this or like that. But they're attributes and they're adjectives that simply speak the truth. Right? Calling him Ibn Zarqa is not a false statement. He is in fact the son of Zarqa, who was an unrighteous woman. It's the fact that she was an unrighteous woman and that they now take pride in being from that lineage, and that unrighteousness has carried down through the lineage and they all stand by those values, that's what's the problem. Not the fact that you point that out and say, oh son of so-and-so. So it's not a matter of calling someone names in a way that's purely insulting and where you're manufacturing something and lying in some way to just to get a score, to score a point with them. Rather, you're mentioning the truth, which happens to be terrible and heinous, here for the purpose of embarrassing the person, for the purpose of putting the person in his place, because he's arrogant, because he deserves this kind of treatment. Right? So we shouldn't think of these moral imperatives that we have as being absolute. The prohibition against insulting is true, it is in place under normal circumstances, but there is a time for insults as well. The prohibition against arrogance, for instance, takabbur, is there, but there's a time for takabbur as well, right? The same Ahlul Bayt that teach us not to be mutakabbir, not to be arrogant, they also say if you're faced with someone who's arrogant, then you be arrogant to them. Right? Put them in their place. Right? Strategically, you figure out what's the best thing. You don't turn the other cheek when someone's going to hit you on the other cheek as well. That's the time when you turn your fist towards them and you put up a fight against that person. Right? So it's a that has to be decided on you know, in those circumstances, but we shouldn't think that a Muslim ideally should always be pacifistic, always be, you know, kind and soft and gentle. There are times when harshness is the duty of the hour. And so the Imam is acting on this, he calls him Yabna Zarqa. So by doing this, he buys some time, feeds into Walid's desires anyway, and they decide that, you know, tomorrow they'll gather and everything, they can take care of the public bay'ah then. So he allays the concerns of Walid and Marwan in that way. He's able to get out of the situation in a peaceable way, and he goes back with his escorts. The following day, the whole day goes, Ibn Zubayr escapes during that night, that very night. Imam Hussein stays another day. So that one night where he was summoned, the next day he also stays. During that day, he tries to wrap up things, consults with his family members to decide what's the next plan, what should I do. The next evening is when Walid finally sends soldiers to come and escort Imam Hussein to the masjid to take that public bay'ah that they talked about the previous day. Again, Imam Hussein is able to turn them away and say, you know, it's late now, let's get to bed, and tomorrow morning we'll see what happens. And so he's able to buy one additional night. So during this time, Imam Hussein, he consults with his family members. There's one consultation in particular that I want to speak about. So he approaches Muhammad ibn Hanafiya. So Muhammad ibn Hanafiya is his half-brother. Right, Imam Ali's a wife that he married after Lady Fatima passed away. She's known as Al-Hanafiya, and so Muhammad is the son of Imam Ali through this other wife of his. And he is someone who is very prominent. In all the battles of Imam Ali al-Islam, in Jamal and Siffin, and in the battle with the Khawarij as well, he played a prominent role. He was right there as one of the generals, one of those prominent people that the Imam would entrust with various important tasks in the battle. He was part of the Ahlul Bayt. The time when Imam Ali sent his sons to go and give water to Uthman ibn Affan when he was being his house was surrounded by the protesters, and Muhammad ibn Hanafiya was also one of the three that were sent in with water to relieve Uthman of his thirst. So he's an outstanding person. We'll see in the aftermath of Karbala as well, during the Tawabi and Mukhtar's uprising, that Muhammad ibn Hanafiya plays a significant role. He is, in reality, our historians now understand him to be the public face of the Imamah. At a time after Karbala, when Imam Zain al-Abidin was not able to take any public stance, could not have any political view publicly because of the scrutiny, because of what had just happened at Karbala, and for so many reasons, it was Muhammad al-Hanafiya, his uncle, Imam Zain al-Abidin's uncle, who was able to play that role of being the liaison between the Imam and Mukhtar. And for this reason, he is maligned in history. Right? And this is also, there's a lesson in this as well. So sometimes we find that history treats certain people in less than favorable ways. It mentions certain faults of certain people, but we know on the other hand that they're supposed to be righteous people. So we have conflicting reports between what the Ahlul Bayt are telling us and what other historical sources are telling us. They tell us that Muhammad al-Hanafiya, for instance, challenged Imam Sajjad and claimed that he was the Imam and not Imam Sajjad. So we have a hadith like this. Even in Al-Kafi, that hadith comes. We have claims that he claimed the Imamah for himself and that Mukhtar was his agent and they were somehow claiming something else besides, that was other than Imam Sajjad. So we have reports like that. But we should be always suspicious of reports that are in the favor of our enemies. Right? Reports that cast doubt on people who are favorable to us, that are and those doubts help the enemy's stance, then we should treat those things with suspicion and scrutinize them. And our historians have done that, and they've come to the understanding that those are malicious lies that were attributed to Muhammad ibn Hanafiya, that he wasn't actually like that. In fact, just the opposite, he was a loyal supporter of not only his brothers Imam Hassan al Hussein, but also his nephew Imam Sajjad. And even if he did engage, there's one hadith in Al-Kafi where he publicly challenges Imam Sajjad, and they say, you know, let's go to Hajar al-Aswad and let Hajar al-Aswad, you know, judge between us and tell us who's the Imam. And so Muhammad al-Hanafiya, he calls out to Hajar al-Aswad and says, you know, oh Hajar al-Aswad, you know, speak if I'm truly the Imam, and is silent. And Imam Zain al-Abidin speaks to Hajar al-Aswad and it speaks and says that you are in fact the Imam. And so this is a public display, and then after that, Ibn Hanafiya, he submits to the Imam and accepts it. Our historians' understanding of that hadith, even if it's true, it was the Ahlul Bayt's way of alleviating those rumors that were being spread. People were making these claims that Muhammad ibn Hanafiya was making these claims. They put this almost like a skit together to make a public show of him doing this, but then showing publicly that Imam Zain al-Abidin's claim is true and my claim is false. Not that he actually had a true claim. That's the only way you can make sense of all the other praise that we have from the Ahlul Bayt for this figure. So Imam Hussein, he comes to his brother and he asks him for advice and says, you know, what should I do? This also raises some questions. Let me read through the question and answer and the advice that Muhammad ibn Hanafiya gives to Imam Hussein, and then I want to speak a little bit about this whole idea about the Imam asking for advice from his brother. He says, Ya akhi anta ahabbu an-nasi ilayya wa a'azzuhum alayya wa lastu addakhiru an-nasihata li ahadin min al-khalqi illa lak. So Muhammad tells Imam Hussein that you are the most dear person to me, and I don't have such goodwill for anyone as I have for you. So I want what's best for you. Your best interest is what I have at heart. وَأَنْتَ أَحَقُّ بِهَا. He says, تَنَحَّ بِبَيْعَتِكَ عَنْ يَزِيد ibn Muawiyah وَعَنِ الْأَمْصَارِ مَسْتَطَعْتِ. His advice to Imam Hussein is, as much as you can, avoid giving your pledge of allegiance to Muawiyah, to Yazid. Also avoid settling down in any of these different cities that might be, you know, tempting, Kufa or Basra or Mecca or any of these places. Avoid those major cities as well. So avoid Bay'ah and avoid those cities as much as you can. ثُمَّ أَبْعَثْ بِرُسُلِكَ إِلَى النَّاسِ. And in the meantime, send your messengers out to all these different places, all these different cities. فَإِنْ بَايَعُوكَ حَمِدْتَ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ ذَلِكَ. If they offer their allegiance to you, then alhamdulillah, that's good. And then you can act on that. وَإِنْ اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَىٰ غَيْرِكَ لَمْ يَنْقُسِ اللَّهُ بِذَلِكَ دِينَكَ وَلَا أَقْلَكَ وَلَمْ تَذْهَبْ مُرُوءَتُكَ. And if they decide that they want to put their allegiance behind someone else, whether it be Yazid or Ibn Zubair or whoever else, that's fine too. At least you are intact. This doesn't compromise your character, your stance, your honor and dignity. Nothing is compromised because you've taken a safe route. You've first put out your feelers, come to a proper decision based on the support of the people or the lack of support, and you are now intact. وإني أخاف عليك أن تدخل مصر من هذه الأمصار فيختلف الناس بينهم فطائفة معك وأخرى عليك فيقتتلون فتكون بأول الأسنة غلظة. He says, my fear is that you will go to one of these cities, choose one because you have some inkling of support from there, and that the people of that city won't be unanimous in their support for you. They will fight amongst themselves. Some will be in support of you and some will be against you. And a civil war will break out in that city, and that you will be the first casualty of that civil war. فَإِذَنْ خَيْرُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ كُلِّهَا نَفْسًا وَأَبًا وَأُمًّا أَضْيَعُهَا دَمًا وَأَذَلُّهَا أَهْلًا. In such a case, if you were killed, then the very best and most virtuous and the greatest of this ummah will be destroyed as the worst of them. You'll be disgraced in the crossfire of the civil war. So Imam Hussein turns to Muhammad again and says, فَأَيْنَ أَذْهَبْ. Where should I go? قَالَ تَنْزِلُ مَكَّةَ فَإِنْ اطْمَأَنَّتْ بِكَ الدَّارُ وَإِلَّا لَحِقْتَ بِالرِّمَالِ وَشِعَبِ الْجِبَالِ وَخَرَجْتَ مِنْ بَلَدٍ إِلَىٰ آخَرٍ حَتَّى تَنْظُرَ مَا يَصِيرُ إِلَيْهِ أَمْرُ النَّاسِ. He says, you should go to Mecca. Right, it's Hajj season now. Go to Mecca, and if that's good enough, if it's safe there, great. If not, then get out of Mecca and go into the desert, go into the mountains, find a place to hide, and then you send out your feelers and send out your messengers from there. فَإِنَّكَ أَصْلُ مَا تَكُونُ رَأْيًا وَأَحْزَمُهُ عَمَلًا حَتَّى تَسْتَقْبِلَ الْأُمُورَ إِسْتِقْبَالًا وَلَا تَكُونُ الْأُمُورُ أَبَدًا أَشْكَلَ عَلَيْكَ مِنْهَا حِينَ تَسْتَدْبِرُهَا إِسْتِقْبَالًا. He says you should be proactive. The best thing you can do is to be proactive in the way that I mentioned. Send out those feelers, be ahead of everything, find out your information so you can make the best decision. Don't wait and react to see what happens, and then you react to the changing events that are taking place. So he gives that kind of advice. فَقَالَ الْحُسَيْنِ يَا أَخِي لَوْ لَمْ يَكُنْ فِي الدُّنْيَا مَلْجَأً وَلَا مَأْوًا لَمَا بَايَعْتُ يَزِيدَ الْمُعَاوِيَةَ أَبَدًا. He says, the bottom line that Imam Hussein says to his brother is that no matter what happens, even if there's no safe place on earth for me to hide, the red line that I'm not willing to cross is giving bay'ah to Yazid. That's really significant for us as well, because that really defines everything the Imam does from here on out. He is strategizing and trying to figure out his different moves in all these different ways, but the one thing that he's not willing to compromise on is this bay'ah. He will not do that, but he'll do other things. If it means going off into the mountains and living as a hermit, that if that's the best option, he'll do that. If it means going to Kufa or wherever else and finding supporters there and launching a revolution, he'll do that. Whatever is in the best interest of his purpose, he'll do, but this is one thing he's not willing to do. Imam Hassan was willing to do it. Sometimes the Shia are under the impression that Imam Hassan was different from Imam Hussein. Imam Hassan was more pacifistic, that's why he compromised with Muawiyah. Imam Hussein, he was the one who was more proactive and more, you know, courageous. That's why he refused to give to compromise with Yazid. That's a mistake in our understanding of the Ma'sumin. Right? The Ma'sumin do what's best according to the guidance they receive and according to their own intellect, which is greater than the intellect of all people combined, according to different hadith. They do what's best in their time, in their circumstances, for the best possible results for God's cause. Right? So if Imam Hassan decided that the treaty with Muawiyah was best, it was for those reasons that I mentioned earlier. Muawiyah is a formidable enemy. And the only thing he could do, with the lack of support and an enemy like Muawiyah, the only thing he could do was at least prevent any further bloodshed. Whereas now with Yazid, there's no longer that threat. He's not formidable like Muawiyah is. He's evil, just as evil, if not more evil than Muawiyah, but he's not clever. He's not cunning. He doesn't have the propaganda machine and the wit to outsmart the Muslims the way Muawiyah was able to do. And so now in this time, and that's one thing. And the other thing is that Yazid is mutajahir bil fisq. Right, Muawiyah, as I said, he put on a show of being a pious person. Right, Yazid doesn't bother. And so that's incredibly important. To have sin publicly sanctioned, publicly performed, is a social evil that cannot be tolerated. But as soon as any person publicly does it and goes unpunished, and now you have the ruler who publicly does it and no one can say anything, then it's just asking for complete corruption throughout the ummah. Who's gonna bother trying to be righteous and avoid sin if the ruler himself, who has full control over everyone, is openly committing all these sins? And so now, if this kind of a person is ruling, and he says, "Wa ala al-Islam as-salam," right? The Imam's his statement was that we can bid farewell to Islam if someone like Yazid takes the reins of rulership over the Ummah of Muslims. And so it's not that the Imams themselves have differing opinions and Imam Hassan was not courageous, God forbid, and Imam Hussein is more courageous or something like that, but rather the circumstances themselves have significantly changed. We can understand that change. And based on the wisdom that both of them had at the time of Imam Hassan, both Imam Hussein and Imam Hassan decided together that was the best course of action. And now if Imam Hassan was alive at this point, they would also both decide that now circumstances have changed. Yazid is not like Muawiyah and our strategy is going to be completely different. There's no room for compromise at this point. Right, so let's make sure that we understand the imams, understand the position of the imam, and don't impute things that are less than what the imams are worried about. So this is the advice that Muhammad ibn Hanafiya gave. The time is running short, and so I'm going to put off the discussion of a couple of questions that I want you to think about for tomorrow. One is, the Imam, as we just saw, he came to his brother, who's not a ma'sum, and he asked for advice. Right? He did mashwara. He sought his advice, his counsel. How does that fit with our understanding of who the Imam is? Right? We have this understanding that the Imam has divine knowledge, he's divinely guided. Right? He gets his information directly from Allah, then how is it that he's asking for advice from a person, even a righteous person, a great person like Muhammad al-Hanafiya, but how does this fit with our conception of what the Imam is and who he is? Right, so think about that and see what reflections you might have on that, and we'll discuss it tomorrow, inshallah. So we want to think about that, the function of mashwara. It's not just Imam Hussein, think of the Prophet as well. He also did mashwara on so many occasions where he would ask his companions, what do you think is the best strategy here? Should we go out to fight them, go in to fight them? What's the best strategy? And they would give their input and he would follow their advice, not overrule them and say, no, we're not going to follow any of that into our own, what I think is best. So what is this? What is the role of this mashwara and how does that fit with the personality of the Ma'sumin? Recite the salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
So right now we've been talking about the year 60... when Muawiyah passed away, a few years before this we had an incident. In the year 58 or 59, during Hajj season, Imam Hussein was there. There was a failing in the rule of Muawiyah at that time for different reasons. There were some revolts in different places. And so there was a weakening in his grasp on the Ummah. And so for that reason, Imam Hussein decides at Hajj, at Mina, to call forth various companions, of course the Ahlul Bayt, I mean the broader Banu Hashim, and then other companions, and even Tabi'een. Tabi'een are the second generation, the students of the companions of the Prophet, who themselves didn't see the Prophet, but they're now students of those companions who did see the Prophet. So they are Imam Hussein's generation, basically. So he calls them together. We're told something on the order of 700 of these Tabi'een, 200 companions gathered together, along with the Banu Hashim, around the Imam. The Imam introduces himself and reminds the people present who he is, his connection to the Prophet, his own virtue, the virtue of the family of the Ahlul Bayt. And after doing all of this, he then turns to these companions and these people and he warns them that they haven't fully taken heed of the stories of the Bani Israel that are mentioned in the Quran, and that they are now falling prey to the same tendencies that led to the downfall of the Bani Israel, and by doing that, they are failing in their duties. So he mentions that it was the leadership of the Bani Israel, right? The priests, they began to turn a blind eye to the evil that was being perpetrated in the Ummah. They began to become too comfortable in their positions of wealth and power, and became too cozy sometimes with the temporal authorities, the rulers of their time, and would start to compromise on Allah's teachings for the sake of keeping the wealthy happy and the powerful happy. They started to ignore the needs of the people and allow people to be trampled by the rulers on their watch, and they didn't say anything. And he says that you are guilty of the same thing. You, as the companions of the Prophet, have a name. You're famous throughout the Ummah as those people who fought alongside the Prophet, studied at the feet of the Prophet. And just the name of a Sahabi and companion of the Prophet carries with it this kind of weight. You as Tabi'een, you as students of these great companions, you also have an incredible amount of power and influence over people. Instead of using that to enforce justice, to fight for the downtrodden, you're becoming cozy with the rulers, you're accepting governorships and different kinds of positions and monetary payoffs from Muawiyah and from the ruler, and you've basically sold out. And so it really comes down hard on these people. The response is favorable at that time. The people realize their guilt, they feel sorry, they take to heart what the Imam is saying, and they make promises that if you rise up, if you do something about it, then we'll support you. On the day of Ashura, we have a similar gathering. We'll learn on the morning of Ashura, before the battle commences, the Imam sends some companions out, and then he himself also comes out on his camel, which is significant. The symbolism of coming out on the camel is that I'm not coming out to fight, I'm coming out to speak to you. And he comes out on his camel, fully dressed in his armor and in his robes and everything, and he addresses the people of Kufa and he says, "Do you know who I am? Do you recognize that I am Hussein, the son of Ali and Fatima? I'm the grandson of the Prophet, but I'm the last of the Ashab al-Kisa. If I'm gone, if you carry through with what you want to do, if you kill me, then the very last connection that you have to the Prophet is severed. The last member of the Ahlul Bayt that are mentioned in Innama yuridullahu liyudhhiba ankum ar-rijsa ahlal bayt wa yutahhirakum tathira is now
going
to be gone. He asks them to recall and to admit that they recognize that he is, according to the Prophet, one of the Sayyidina Shababi Ahlul Jannah, one of the foremost of the youth of paradise. Do you recognize that I am the son of the Prophet himself, through his daughter Fatima. Do you recognize that, all these things that the Prophet has said, the position that the Ahlul Bayt have, the position that my father Ali had, the position that Fatima had, do you recognize the fact that the Prophet equated my pleasure and displeasure with his own pleasure and displeasure? And his pleasure and displeasure is equivalent with God's pleasure and displeasure. If I am displeased, then that means God himself is displeased. And if I am pleased, then only God is pleased. Do you recognize who I am? Then he turns to the things that he's wearing, even the artifacts that he has on his body, that he brings into Karbala. He says, this imamah that I am wearing, this turban that I am now wearing, do you recognize that this is sahab, the turban that the Messenger of God used to wear? Do you recognize that the sword that I now carry is the sword of my father? The abba that I wear now into battle is the abba of the Prophet ﷺ. He says, if you recognize all of this, who I am, what Ahlul Bayt I am from, the fact that I am your connection to the Prophet, you claim to be Muslims and followers of that Prophet, I am dressed in the garb of the Prophet himself, then why are you so willing and so eager to kill me? The response that the Maqatil tell us comes from the soldiers of the Kufans is that, we understand all of what you're saying. We know all of that, fine, we admit all of that. But they say, look at the water that you see behind us of the Furat, of the Euphrates. This is water that the dogs and pigs of Kufa are free to wallow in. They drink at will. But they say, we swear, despite all that we know about you, we refuse to let you taste it at all. And we insist on killing you while you are thirsty, just as you did to Uthman ibn Affan, when Imam Hussein is the one who had given water to Uthman ibn Affan. And this is the kind of response he gets on the battlefield of Karbala. As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdillah wa ala al-arwah allati halat bi fina'ik alayka minni salamu allahi abadan ma baqi wa baqiya al-layl wa al-nahar ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب أعظم الله أجورنا في مصابنا في الحسين عليه السلام وجعلنا وإياكم من الطالبين بثأر مع وليه الإمام المهدي من آل محمد عليه السلام
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد